Well, how are you doing? It's a beautiful Tuesday. I am going to do a couple practice thesis statements, talk a little bit about the AP exam, but also we're doing a little bit of the Cold War. Still have to move on with class. And this will be only one of two days I'm going to talk about the 50s in class. I'm also going to do it on Thursday, but I'm going to do the same deal, talk a little bit about the AP exam. And don't forget the AP exam is, wow, it's Friday. So by tomorrow, you should get some kind of key or whatever they're calling it from the College Board. They should email you that. If you have not done that AP demo and you're taking the test, you better do it now. Well, as soon as I'm done here. But, but you have to get that done. And make sure that you've read through those things I gave you from the College Board. Print out if you can, or at least have it on screen, that daily checklist, and do it before Friday so you don't have to worry about it on Friday. Make sure you know if you're going to write it, if you're going to type it, you have everything ready for Friday morning. You'll have it done at 11, or have it done today or tomorrow so you don't have to worry about it Friday morning, so you can get a good sleep, have breakfast, enjoy yourself, and then get ready for 45 minutes to write an essay. And okay, so for some reason it just wasn't coming up. I had to give an update for my studio program where I'm able to do all this amazing special effects. Now, if I had a green screen, I could do it, but I don't want to go through a process of the green screen. Maybe I'll just get a bucket of paint and just splotch some green paint on the wall. So I think it'd be kind of cool if I was talking and like roller coasters to be going by. I don't know, something to think about. We'll work on that. Hopefully, we won't have to worry about it next year, but you never know. Okay, so I will accept through noon today any additional things you want to do on your DBQ about the atomic bomb or whatever it might be. And I've already gotten a few back from people, and they're doing very well. Outside information, it's so important. You take what's in the documents and you relate to outside information. And don't forget, I'm going to say this every day until you take the test. No quotes. I know I've said that from the very first day I gave the AP, or we start talking about DBQs. Don't quote. And I know either people forget or they're so used to saying, well, I got to get quotes in. That's what other teachers say. Or no, not for this. This is a different type of test. And so the very first handout I gave you on how to write a DBQ, it says right on the top, no quotes. You can use one time, maybe one little snip of five words at the most, just a little bit, but that's it. I said that the very first day. And so I just want to make that very clear. Trust me, if you quote and use long quotes, they will immediately think you don't know what you're talking about and you're just trying to fill space by copying. The same thing when you're reading a document and you decide, let's tell everything what's in there, let's put down some very detailed facts. Like a lot of you on the DBQ for the atomic bomb wrote about the kind of made up troop numbers that Secretary of War Stimson used in Document A. Stimson was trying to justify dropping the atomic bomb, by the way. The drop of the atomic bomb is by definition shockingly controversial. So him and Truman and the rest of them are going to spend literally the rest of their life trying to justify it. But he's giving these numbers of troop totals. You don't need to copy that down. You just need to show that he's justifying dropping the atomic bomb. He's giving a reason that he's trying to say the invasion would have been so bloody we had no choice. Now, that's not really true. There's always choices, but that's what he's saying. So don't copy that facts down. Use your own words. And if you go on my webpage, that's why I have it on there, on my webpage, and I have, link to Teams, YouTube channel. I still have the link to Clever. I don't know why I have that still up there because that turned out to be a no. In fact, I'm getting rid of it right now. But if you go on there and you see the links to AP History, I have all the units and YouTube broadcasts, but on the assignment page,
I've been putting in, the really big thing about the ones we've done in class since we've been stuck at home, units, Great Depression, World War I, and World War II. But if you hit that, how to write a DBQ or long essay, I have all that information down there, the rubric for the new DBQ. That's with the College Board, but I've already given you that. But one thing I want to show you, I've given you two samples. They've been on here for a while, but I don't know if you've seen them. Two samples. And the first one is sample DBQ. And okay, it was a Word document when I converted it to Google Docs to make it easier to share. It kind of, the font got weird, but if you download it to Word, it'll come in better. But it has the question, the ultimate cause of the Civil War of conflicts over slavery, a few documents. I have a sample brainstorm list, thesis, etc. And you notice I have on my outline, I have documents directly relating to facts. You gotta relate it to stuff that things that you know outside information. And then a sample paragraph using the documents. I do the same thing for Vietnam. I have a question for Vietnam. I have a couple documents. I have a sample thesis statement. And then actually what I did is here for document A, I show a sample document, and then I give you how to use it in a sentence. Document B, sample document, how to use it in a sentence. Document C, and how to use it in a sentence. So all that's there if you want another, take another quick look, or just want something, maybe Friday morning just to kind of refresh your memory. All that's on my webpage. I have a significant amount of information on my webpage. And the same deal here. I have the AP test review, the test review on the short one I gave you for 1896 to 1945. I have all that stuff on there. All right, so then let's get back to class. And so when we quit, I talked about I mentioned how people are living longer, the baby boom, planned obsolescence, purposely making things so they break. And I should add, the thing about it is that there's so much excess capital and so they can produce so many goods that they need people to constantly buy things. And that's why we are on the edge of such a potentially, it's a potential big economic problem right now. It's because there's no demand, because people aren't buying things. I just listened to the radio today on National Public Radio, and they're just talking about how people are saving more money, those who have money, because it's like, well, I can't spend anyways, and if tomorrow's bad, I better hold on to my money now. And so that was the issue about planned obsolescence in the 50s. They didn't want people to hold on to our money, to their money. Today, 80% of our economy is based upon consumer spending. And if people don't spend money, businesses shut their doors and there's unemployment, there's layoffs. That is the way the economy, our just-in-time economy works now. It doesn't work if there's emergencies. There's real, that's another story for down the road. And I talked about the role of women, the development of the cult of domesticity. Sorry, I accidentally got rid of that. And how there was almost a desperation to get back to normalcy. I told you about my grandma who worked in a bomber factory, and even though she was ahead, had a much more important role and promotion, and was a supervisor to many over many men, she got a pink slip along with all the women in the bank got to keep their jobs. And so women wanted to get back to this and to push this role of women. That women can't really go into the man's world as men go off to a more exciting world. In fact, this picture really shows it. I didn't mention it last week, but here he is going off to the exciting world of work while she stays home. And it really shows the divide, the different spheres. This one kind of does here too, doesn't it? Here they are, the family in front, and he's almost like a tourist into the family. Now, of course, life isn't really like that. A lot of this mythology, but if you ever watch television shows from the 1950s, and I know all of you love Leave It to Beaver or Father's Knows Best, that's what the role of women were, and that was pushed into women's head. I should add, that meant if a woman wants to do something other than get married and have children. She's weird. There's something wrong with her. It's just, yeah, there's something. And you can go into what that might mean down the road. So, and I showed you this at the end of the bell. End of the period. So what we get here is a big shift in what it means to be an American, a new American dream, because of the Great Compression, that shrinking of the gap between the rich and the poor that happened because of the New Deal and because of liberal Keynesian economics. There are more people than ever before that are so-called middle class. They can afford some of the trappings of an upper class life without going into a great deal of debt. Pay was going up for most people, and the thought was, even if they're not quite there yet, they're not quite able to afford that. There's two things that come out of that. First off, someday they will, and more importantly, their kids might. And you get this generation after generation. What I grew up in was this just knowledge that it's gonna be better tomorrow, and for when I was a little kid, I'm probably gonna do better than my parents. Just that was just because they did better to their parents and so on. And that's part of the reason why there is such an unease today, because it's not like that anymore. Part of the reason is, as you can see from that picture right here, is because look how happy they are because they're eating lard. And that was also part of the American dream. Remember, the old American dream was that Thomas Jefferson's ideal. And this remained all the way to the Great Depression. Still, you know, to get that little farm, that little piece of land, call your own, and you'll be an independent yeoman farmer. And so a lot of people, when they did get money, the whole goal was, I'll then go to the farm. And yeah, that still exists today. A lot of wealthy people do that. In fact, a lot of them are doing it today. Those who are rich and can afford to isolate themselves during this pandemic are looking at real estate in Montana. But what became the symbols of the new American dream, and that's why I have that picture right there of that very creepy looking family, was get a home, be able to buy that car, and I put down television. Now, television would come to me, you know, all those newfangled consumer electronics. You know, that includes, like, you know, things I can get that washer and dryer and get things like that. That new American dream. And even though most Americans still cannot afford it, more and more every year could. And you'll see that idea going all the way into your lifetime. In the early 2000s, it was like, I got to get that home, got to get that home. And a significant number of people went into debt to buy that home, creating a housing bubble that when it crashed would destroy the entire world's economy in 2008. And so there's that feeling still exists today. It's different now. Younger people aren't owning their homes and can't afford it. We are in a hinge moment right now. So that's where we're getting, my point is. But the thing was, there was a massive housing shortage. Okay, there was a real estate boom in the 1920s. But I've already mentioned that before. But then obviously it ended with the Great Depression, the crash in real estate values, asset prices tanked. And even when the country started getting out of the Depression in the late 1930s, then World War II hit. No one's building houses during World War II. There's a shortage of material and rationing. And so after the war, all of a sudden you have more people with more money than ever before. They want to buy homes. They now have new families with the baby booms and a housing shortage. And so housing prices just skyrocketed. So it's going to lead to a big housing boom. By the way, the house that I'm in now was built, one of the few houses built during the Great Depression. It was built in 1936. So you have the development of suburbia as a way to meet that housing shortage, which for some reason I decided to type again. But property values inside cities are always more. If you're looking for houses today, you know, it's a lot more expensive to buy a home inside Helena, for the most part, than out in the valley. That's why so many people live in the valley, and that's why now we have East Helena and East Helena High School. That's mascots named after a bunch of pro-Confederate murderers. But hey, that's another story. Anyways, and this would lead to people, okay, let's take up some of these farmland, these tracts outside, relatively cheap, and quickly build homes. And this could never happen if not for the changes of the 1950. And the first really big one was Levittown. And I'll show you a little video clip about Bill Levitt. Please let me know if it works or not. I have my earbuds in. But please let me know if it works or not. But Levittown. And Bill Levitt would make, okay, there are other suburban areas before, but Levitt was the first one to really take advantage of this shortage of housing, but also new construction methods. New construction methods. And this never could have happened without dependence upon the automobile. All of these are specifically designed for people to be able to drive, drive from their new homes in the suburbs, drive to work, and then drive back, drive to the store. Everything's based on the car. Our real dependence upon the automobile, I mean, absolute dependence upon the automobile and therefore gasoline and fossil fuels and everything else, would come about, you really see it in the 1950s. So look at one of these Levitt towns. Before suburbia, cities, when they would be actually planned, especially by the end of the 19th century, they'd make them in a nice grid pattern. Nice little checks and nice little squares. And this means there's a lot of space taken up in, taken up by roads. So I live in one of the older parts of Helena, and I live on a nice grid pattern, and there's a lot of streets. There's a lot of space taken up by streets. Why do they do that? You think, what? Why? You're wasting all this real estate. Because everyone's walking. If you're walking, you need a lot of streets because it takes a long time to get there. But if you're not walking, you don't need as many exchanges. You just make long roads because you're driving. And that's why if you go to places, well, here's Levittown, we go to like Sunhaven. I'm just giving you an example because it's right near Capitol High. Remember, we used to go there. And how the streets wind, it's not a grid pattern. That's because of cars. In fact, you also notice a lot of places don't have sidewalks because why would you ever need a sidewalk? Everyone's driving. And so with that, here's a Levittown, and yes, look at the price. Relatively low priced, and the system was set up so people could borrow money relatively cheap. They were mortgages were backed up by the federal government, and so the federal government set up a program to back it up only to white people, and this will have grave consequences down the road. It's called redlining, and I've mentioned that once before. But we're going to watch just a little clip. Now, here's the deal. Let me know, please, let me know if you can't hear this. Of course, I'll know if I can.
No one is to blame. Yet.
Okay, you can't. Just give me a sec. Do-do-do. Okay, let's try again. Let me know if you can't hear it.
No one is to blame, yet everyone is to blame. There's been a lag in home construction for more than 15 years.
In 1945, Americans needed 5 million new low-cost homes, and they needed them right away.
Now there are building materials.
The elusive dream of home ownership would soon be realized by a man about to fulfill a dream of his own and invent a new phenomenon, suburbia.
Bill Levitt, as a young man working with the Seabees in World War II, has this brilliant idea, taking
Seabees
some of the techniques he's seeing right then and there in World War II, building airstrips, putting up housing for GIs, and bringing them back to America for ordinary people. He's sitting there at night.
So it must work.
With his pals in the Pacific in World War II and saying, you know, what do you want when you get home? Well, I want a house and a car.
American dream.
Bill Levitt's special genius was figuring out how to mass produce the American dream.
So what Bill Levitt did is, and everyone's going to follow, he took the tools of the Industrial Revolution, of standardization, of the assembly line, and brought it to homes. Prefabricated pieces to the homes. And so today, you look at housing where they make, even though the houses don't all necessarily look the same, but they have prefabricated pieces they can put together and make very quickly. And unlike an assembly line, where you can move like the car down the line, they have the crew move from home to home. So the roofing crew, the flooring crew, the foundation crew, whatever it might be.
We first came to see that property where they were going to build. It was potato farms, and it stretched like from here to eternity. You would see concrete foundations, nothing but concrete with the heat in. And then down the road there, we were in the midst of all the dust, was a frame job going on. And then down on the dust was where he completed, was the sheathing going. And then down the road a bit, and it was like putting your clothes on, from your socks on first, you know, and then putting your underwear on and the shirt, and finally way down on the other end.
It was a finished product.
It was a finished house. And yet, you could see how it grew.
Okay, this is great. And they actually moved this fast. They were quick as cats.
Before the war, the average contractor built 5 houses a year. In Levittown, Long Island, they built 36 houses a day, a grand total of 17,450.
I love this.
Designed for a family of 4, Levitt's basic Cape Cod sold for a minimum down payment at a price most people could afford.
I think there's a great ad in there. Mr. Veteran, you're a lucky guy. You know, you can buy this house with $100 down. The first day that they were going to sell them, the lines were, I mean, people started lining up 72 hours before the houses went on sale. Even Levitt was stunned.
A second Levittown in Pennsylvania was every bit as successful as the Long Island Levittown. Everyone, it seemed, wanted a Bill Levitt home.
I beg your pardon, sir. Would you mind telling me who you are and where you're from?
I'm David Poole from Atlantic City, New Jersey.
And would you tell me why you're moving here to Levittown?
Well, I'm working in this area now, and I've looked the houses over, and I think it's a fine place to raise a family, so I've decided to buy one.
Very good, sir.
My house was a little Cape Cod cottage with a trellis over the door and
I love the home
one window on either side. And it was 4 rooms, nice kitchen, an eat-in kitchen, decent-sized living room, 2 small bedrooms, and a bathroom, and it had doors that I could close and open and close and open with. We had always lived in furnished rooms. We had no privacy whatsoever, no, nothing. It was perfect for a young couple.
And we had a Bendix in the kitchen.
That's right, Bendix washing machine in the kitchen. First time I ever saw a
big
a washing
deal
machine
having a washing machine.
And we fell in love because that washing machine was underneath the stairs, you know. And before that, when we had the baby, you know, it was like 16, 17 diapers a day to wash. Boil them on the stove.
That's how you wash the diapers.
And needless to say, the family wanted to get rid of us, too. They didn't need a baby that was crying in that, you know, tight quarters. You know, and to have a house of your own. Man, that was the way we felt, you know.
After the Depression, all this has come on, so it was kind of a gift from heaven, you know, you found these wonderful houses to move in.
And the best thing about it, I guess, was our independence. It was the first time we were away from our parents, completely independent, and we did what we wanted when we wanted. Like any kids, they wanted to be on their own, and we were.
And we could start our family.
That's right. And the rapport between neighbors was, at first, was very good. Excellent, in fact.
Because they were all in the same boat as us. They were all first starting out, mostly young like us, and just starting with their family and their first house, too.
The new middle class, but...
The new middle class families of Levittown had one other thing in common. They were all white.
I walked up to the salesperson, and I said to him, "We're very interested in your house, and we'd like an application." And I remember what he said to me. He looked at me, he said, "It's not me, but the management has not as yet decided whether he's going to sell these houses to Negroes or not." And
You can't believe it. You really thought you had it made. You, you know, everything is falling into place.
Well, I'd like you to conceive that somebody telling you that, and there's no recourse, telling you that openly and outright like that.
Bill Levitt saw himself as a home builder, not as a social engineer, and he refused to sell the blocks. There were court cases against him, and the fact is he was all too typical of what existed in real estate in America in those days, in believing that you did not have to and should not have to sell to people who were not white.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is William Levitt.
So we're just gonna, I'm gonna right there and hang a little bit more about this. But you combine the fact that they just simply would not sell to blacks, and that was not illegal. There was no law anywhere in the United States and in virtually any state that said it was illegal to discriminate against somebody based upon, well, anything. It was not against the law. You might think, wait a second, what about the 14th Amendment? Well, the Supreme Court had ruled that the 14th Amendment only applies to certain very narrow set of laws, which was not the intent of the 14th Amendment, but that's what happened. And this was government policy. They literally called it redlining, where they would keep people who were not white out of neighborhoods. And there would not be any kind of Fair Housing Act as part of the Civil Rights Bill until Lyndon Johnson would force it through Congress in 68. And even then, it was still it's still possible to discriminate to this day. But they would be allowed to bring up lawsuits against that. There would be... our current president, he would be two big lawsuits against discriminating against blacks in his real estate in the 70s and 80s. That's another story.
Well, but, oops,
it's going right to this. But what's going to happen then is this, and it'll soon be called, and I can remember this term being brought up all the time in the 60s and 70s, called urban blight. And what happened was, and they had another name for it, white flight. And middle-class people, people who could afford, who are almost all white, fled the cities and went to the suburbs. Now, of course, at first it started out, you know, oh, I finally get to have a chance to get a home. But then as they left, the tax base of big cities crashed because people with money started fleeing. When the tax base crashed, that means that cities could no longer do things like clean cities, have parks, effective sewage, garbage collection. And all these services collapsed, and then more people fled, making the city worse. And by the 1960s into the 70s, you're going to get parts of big cities that are going to be literal hellholes. And the term for it was urban blight. They used the term all the time in the 60s and 70s would be the use of the word ghetto. I just remember that all the time in the ghetto. That wouldn't be used as much now, but cities started to go broke. Heck, New York City went bankrupt. Cleveland went bankrupt. And this became a major crisis as people left. You see it here in Helena. You ever wonder why they have this kind of weird hodgepodge of buildings in downtown Helena? Same thing happened. Stores and businesses fled, also partially because of cars, outside of downtown. And they started to raise buildings and tear things down as part of, they called it, urban renewal. And you'll also notice that the population are going to be mostly people who are not white. Blacks in urban areas who, remember, they had to go there because of the Great Migration, they would be there. And so that would become the symbol of this, or black, or more and more Hispanic people, because similar thing. That's where they go to get jobs, they can afford to live, and that would encourage more white flight. And so this racial issue would come up. And remember, these are areas that did not have Jim Crow. Yet it's mostly people who are not white that are suffering because of this. And so, at the same time, wow, we keep moving on. You're going to have a very separate and unique teen culture going on. Now, there's always been a generation gap. There's always been a gap between young people and old people for obvious reasons, because young people are younger and older people are older. Science. But, just... Sorry. But what made the generation gap in the 1950s so much different was the increased affluence. More money for more money for people, least overall, more money for families. And that meant more money in the hands of teenagers. And that would lead to a very definite gap, because what you're going to get is there are more young people, teenagers. I'm just using teens, so anywhere from 12 to 20, with more money than ever before. And not overall, there's still significantly high levels of poverty and, of course, the racial issue, but more. That's the point, more. And what we have is you're going to have companies that would begin to market products very specifically for teens, for young people, and not for old people. And this marketing would accelerate that generation gap. These are for teenagers and young people that adults can't have. And so here's a couple examples of it, like drive-in movies and drive-in restaurants. Those are for young people. And that kind of artificially created this divide. Here is Dick Clark, who would be best known for having a very popular show, first radio, then television show, for music. And he's selling Brillo cream because we all know you need a little grease in your hair to kind of slick it back so you look good. This is at a time when no one took a shower in the morning and nobody washed their hair in the morning. That was considered to be weird. Advertising a shampoo, companies would sell that in the late 60s and the 70s as a big deal. You want to do it in the morning. So that idea, people get up and shower and do all the stuff in the morning, which I do. I grew up in that era, even though I was quite old by then. That was a development of the 70s because advertising. And of course, the hula hoop. But the specifically designed for teens, and that accelerated the generation gap. And so it made it like the parents and the children are living in different worlds. Now, I should add, yes, there's always been a generation gap, but never had that marketing that felt that way. I should add, the generation gap is expected. People your age are right on the edge of going on their own, being independent, and you're going to be breaking away from your parents. And that is a natural gap. There's a natural push between that. Because your parents still want to have some control over you. At the same time, you want to have a little bit of freedom. That is natural. And you are also have the most intelligence you're ever going to have right now. The ability to absorb information and learn new things and be more creative. And it's happening right now. Now, I should add, that doesn't make you smarter. And it doesn't make you more capable of doing things, because it's what you do with that potential what matters. Now, I should add, it doesn't mean you know more. I have years of experience. I know more than you. Doesn't make me smarter, but I know more. And that's one thing that parents are like, wait a minute, I know more. I want to tell you what to do. Well, you're at the age where you're just absorbing everything and want to absorb more. It's a conflict, but it really accelerated because of these new products. And so here's a couple examples of like a drive-in. And I love that picture. This is separate, unique teen culture. And if more kids could have afford to drive a car, you saw a little bit of the 20s, but really by the 50s, they could get away from their parents and do things on their own. Like go to movies, and there's people watching a 3D movie with the 3D glasses. Now, this is the time we're back in school. I have my 3D glasses, but they are now locked inside school. And there's no way you can get around the simple fact that that's where you really get modern music come out of this, because of rock and roll music would be marketed to teens. It's their music and it's not your parents' music. You could be different than them, but now you could buy and sell goods like a little record player. And what people would buy are singles called 45s, because they moved at 45 rotations or 45 rotations a minute. They would spin and play. And had two songs, an A side and a B side. And by the way, have you ever seen an LP? I have singles, but I also have LPs. This, an LP. So an LP, this is the Beatles, Abbey Road, and these would come about. They made them then, but they wouldn't become popular until the late 1960s. It was singles, 45s, and I have those too. Yeah, that's what I listen to. But to sell the kids, and so they would market it as something different. And rock and roll had connotations of not only being different, but a little bit kind of, it's yours. It's a secret. It means something else. There's kind of a double entendre there that you can say, ooh, I know something else. And it was a combination of a couple different types of music, but a guy named Alan Freed, who was a radio DJ in Cleveland, and his radio show was mostly white advertisers, but they knew they had to start marketing to kids, and we could get kids listening. We play this new type of music, and he was white, but he started playing groups that were black, who were playing a style of music. The most generic form was called rhythm and blues. And rhythm and blues was kind of a faster blues music that was mostly African-American music, but also white musicians. And white musicians, a lot of them were playing a music, you might call it your country today, they called it hillbilly music, but a faster version of that called rockabilly. And so you have this combination of black and white musicians, black and white musicians that were kind of separate racially because of segregation and the way society was, but they would combine to form rock and roll. And nobody would be more important for this than, also because he's one of my all-time favorites, who just passed away a year ago, Chuck Berry. And Chuck Berry basically invented modern pop music. He invented the music that almost everybody still follows to this day, no matter what type of music, the basic thing where you have verse, chorus, a bridge, which he called the middle eight, sometimes a solo, guitar solo, or some kind of solo, something in there, and then another verse and chorus. Everybody still follows it. That's Chuck Berry. And so let's listen to a little bit of Chuck Berry. Verse, chorus. That's modern music. And he never actually had a number one song because, well, blacks did not get the airplay. He never became rich. He was cheated by music producers, but he invented modern music. But the big thing was Freed played it. This could only mean one thing. What we have is that whites would be dancing, or more affluent whites would be buying music that was more black. But before we get to that, as you can see from this picture, everybody loved the new kind of music. And I gotta be honest with you, that might be the greatest thing ever. This could only mean one thing. They're exhausted. They need to take a break. And that means it's time to write a thesis statement. Oops. Ha ha. So, thesis statement. Quick practice. So what we're talking about here is a thesis statement about the events that led up to the Revolutionary War. The events that led up to the Revolutionary War. And this also should be in your review packet. As luck would have it, I gave you a significant amount of things on your review packet for you to do for this. And so what I'd like you to do is write a quick thesis statement about this. Now, try to get something. The main change in idea is get the X or the main point of the question. You have to mention independence and those years. And this goes all the way through the Revolutionary War. And then you need a blueprint. What are your two paragraphs in this one going to be about? And take some kind of position. What ties it all together? What changed? The view towards what? And so I'll give you a couple minutes about that, and then we'll talk about this. Good practice, good thing for you to think about. I'll also give you a second if you want to look at your review packet. Got a few seconds? I screwed up. I should have the Jeopardy music here. Okay. Sorry about that. I didn't know I changed the move. I wanted you to see the picture again. Okay, let's look at it. Okay, so the thesis. And think about all the things that happened from 1763 to 1783. I mean, think about things that would make great paragraphs. So you have British taxation and mercantilism, or individual ones like the Stamp Act, or Tea Act, Tea Party, or of course the Declaration of Independence, and the Revolutionary War. I mean, I would focus on the two big ones would be something about British taxation and reestablished mercantilism and the Declaration of Independence. And what ties it all together? Well, American independence was before they were part of an empire and accepting British rule. And they begin to think more and more that we have rights. Remember the enlightened views. Remember John Locke and that idea that people are born with unalienable rights of life, liberty, and he said property. The Declaration of Independence said the pursuit of happiness. So with the flowering of Latin ideals of individual rights between 1763 and 1783, the 13 American colonies went from being loyal subjects of the British Empire to demanding independence, starting with protests against British taxation and climaxing in 1776 by declaring independence during the Revolutionary War. And so what ties it all together? All of them are going to be, we have certain rights. We have certain rights. And I address the main point of the question without a doubt. My first body paragraph would be on protests against taxation. And so that's like Stamp Act, Tea Act, etc. And climaxing with the Declaration of Independence. So I can talk about the events leading to or declaring independence. Or talk a little bit about Thomas Paine and the Declaration of Independence and Jefferson. Basic question, that would be a great one to have. Yeah, you never know. But let's look at one of the documents. I gave you this as an example. So document one has this weird teapot that says No Stamp Act and Restore Liberty. And so what is it? Well, this teapot is an anti-mercantilism, anti-Stamp Act. So if you use that, this is referring to opposition to the Stamp Act. This is a great way to talk about the Stamp Act. And very clear, it's bringing up that idea of rights, that Americans have liberty. The big thing would have been were that they have, in the America colonies, we have the rights of Englishmen, rights. And then, what is the bias? What would be used for Hap? This would show the feeling that Americans, their bias, their point of view, whoever made this, are that individuals within the 13 colonies have rights. So that is how the bias would work. And one more quick thing. I'm going to stop it right here. Where's my mouse? When you take the exam, oops, sorry, you got to watch. I want this open. Yeah. So when you have, sorry, your review packet, and you take this test and you're looking at it real quick, okay, just to refresh yourself before you write your thesis statement. Things that you do not include in your body paragraphs and your thesis statements. Things like if you don't mention the Pontiac's War and Proclamation of 1763, the French and Indian War. Maybe you don't mention these acts. Maybe you don't mention the Second Continental Congress. Maybe you don't mention the Treaty of Paris. All of those things that you don't mention in your body paragraphs, those are some of the things that you can use in your context in your opening paragraph. You need that context, and you have it right there in front of you. So if the question's on Jacksonian democracy, find things in there that you don't use. What happened here? Find things you don't use in your body paragraphs. If the question's about the Industrial Revolution, you have a lot of stuff going on, like the Transcontinental Railroad and the Homestead Act and Reconstruction, all those issues. If you don't use it in your body paragraphs, use it for your context. Okay, so that's a really important facet. Let's get back to this picture one more time. That, I should have said that was me, and for some reason I have an X on my hand. Okay, so. And so the big thing we have to get to is, what made rock and roll so successful as a marketing program is, and they literally talk like this. Remember, this was a very racially charged time. This was still a very racist time. You have Chuck Berry. So you have black musicians. Another one was like Fats Domino or the great Little Richard, who just passed away. But they're black musicians at first wave, and they thought, we have to find somebody who is white, but it can play that sound. And doesn't mean they weren't very talented people, but that's what they looked for. That's what would market them and make them great. And yes, they did sanitize it and make it not quite as interesting after this person right here, Elvis, who great voice, who was a young, good-looking guy, and therefore could appeal to younger people. You gotta think we're marketing here. But had a magnificent voice and could do that sound and yet be suitable for more white audiences, more mainstream. And so let's play a little bit of Elvis. Oh, the most popular variety television show, the brand new media television, was Ed Sullivan. And Ed Sullivan had various artists on, various performers. And it was a big deal when he had Elvis on because they had been mostly playing mainstream, older type of music. Or, you know, performers from Broadway, things like that. And he brought on Elvis, and it was a big deal. Now, Elvis would dance, shake, when he sung, and that was seen as too scandalous. And so they only filmed him from the waist up at first. And this made it even more exciting. I got to see what he does. And so the audience for the Ed Sullivan Show was huge when Elvis came on, only to be surpassed when the Beatles would come on. But by then, Ed Sullivan had realized, this is crazy not to have rock and roll stars, and quickly did Elvis on many times afterwards. But let's play a little bit of Ed Sullivan. And this was a big deal to show the mainstream of rock and roll, but there's also a racial content to it.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have a big show, a real big shoe.
Big shoe.
With Elvis Presley headlining tonight. Promise. And during the show, Elvis is going to appear all the way through the show because sometimes people tune in a little late. We've got a great all-star show going along with him, but right now, singing a medley of some of the songs that you enjoy to the extent of boosting them over the million mark, here is Elvis.
Thank you.
You notice how they film them? And this was a very popular song, but by a black artist. So, we got more of Elvis, but we're going to go right. So that is teen culture. That's Elvis. We're going to get back to music. But you have this really dynamic society in the 1950s that would, of course, be dominated by the threat of nuclear war. So let's get to foreign policy. Is that where I want to quit? Am I still doing good? Where's my mouse? Yeah, let's do foreign policy then real fast. So, but the Cold War dominated foreign policy of the 1950s. I can't emphasize this enough. Eisenhower came in. Yes, they did end the Korean War, but the threat, the now threat of Stalin and the Soviets overrode everything. And with the Truman Doctrine now, no American politician could ever look soft on communism. And so, John Foster Dulles, he was a very prominent corporate lawyer. He was also involved in foreign affairs for years. He was known as a hardline anti-communist, and Eisenhower would pick him as his Secretary of State. Now, the reason Eisenhower picked him, well, Eisenhower kind of had an affinity for these corporate lawyers, but the big thing was, is that this allowed Eisenhower to sit back and let Dulles be the face of a very harsh foreign policy, at least rhetoric-wise. And John Foster Dulles had the policy called brinksmanship. And brinksmanship meant that Dulles believed that the Soviets, well, let me rephrase that. Dulles believed the best way to stand up to the Soviets, but more importantly, to stand up to them that would be very effective for domestic American politics, was to go to the very brink of nuclear war, to threaten to use the massive power of American nuclear weapons to potentially destroy the world to stop the Soviets for everything. If the Soviets, and therefore now Red China, does anything, we'll blow the world up. And therefore to the brink of nuclear war to push them back. Now, this is not a very effective foreign policy. And by the way, this is the definition of conservative. This is conservative. This is unilateral. We're not going to have diplomacy. We're not going to talk about this. I'm going to blow the world up. And what are you going to do about it? And a lot of people to this day think, boy, that's great. I mean, it sounds tough. And if people want to look tough on communism, this sounds tough. Now, I got to be clear about it. It's insane. It's absolutely insane. And it will turn out right away how insane it is. But they're counting on the fact that most Americans are watching TV and the Ed Sullivan Show and don't know the details of it. And so it could give that feeling of toughness. And it's policy that's used to this very day. And so he promised then massive retaliation with nuclear weapons. You do anything, like threaten Taiwan across the Formosa Strait from Red China, we blow the world up. We will drop atomic bombs on the Kremlin, which is the capital of the Soviet Union. And it seemed to kind of work at first in Korea. When Eisenhower became president in the summer of 53, there were more peace talks and they got bogged down about the issue of Chinese prisoners of war. And so what they did is they sent more bombers with nuclear weapons to Okinawa and Japan, where the U.S. still has bases after World War II. And the threat of the threat of maybe escalating the war to nuclear war, this threat seemed to get China to finally agree to a peace agreement. Now, as it turned out, no, it didn't. China was ready for peace too. They were both trying to save face, but it seemed to work. And so, massive retaliation. And this will help trigger a huge arms race, an unprecedented arms race, focusing on nuclear weapons. Because once the Soviets had Joe 1, the United States decided we need bigger weapons, and they dubbed it the Super. Now, what the Super means is it's a hydrogen bomb. It's a hydrogen bomb. It is a fission bomb. So an atomic bomb, the bomb dropped on Hiroshima, and the bomb that was dropped on Nagasaki, the Trinity bomb, were fission bombs. And the Trinity bomb, that was the first kind of atomic bomb, the same type of bomb that was dropped on Nagasaki, the first bomb that would be mass produced. Nobody really made the Hiroshima bomb afterwards. It was because it used uranium, the uranium gun weapon, it was called. It was never going to be that big. But the Trinity bomb. But by using that type of bomb, like a Trinity bomb, to explode a core of hydrogen and deuterium and a couple other things, they could create a bigger fusion reaction, and that would make the hydrogen bomb. So a smaller bomb exploding and making a bigger bomb. And they dubbed this the super. Now the United States, this was theoretical, and they were worried about the bomb because it could be arbitrarily too big. But after the Soviets exploded their atomic bomb, Truman ordered, "We got to do it. Let's go. You know, why the hell are we making it?" This is that quote. And so they start to make the hydrogen bomb. The first hydrogen bomb would be codenamed Mike 1. Mike 1. And to give you an idea of the scope, by the way, this is the Bravo explosion, so a little bit future, a bigger hydrogen bomb. But Mike 1, I use this scale to give you an idea of how big this bomb was. So, you see, this is the biggest bomb ever exploded in the atmosphere, called the Tsar Bomba, and it's a Soviet bomb. It was 50 megatons, 50 million tons of TNT, and they exploded that in Siberia. Here's Mike, the first hydrogen bomb, 10 megatons, Bravo 15 megatons. Massive, million tons. Oh, see these two little dots here? See these two little tiny things here? That's the Hiroshima bomb, and that's the Trinity bomb. That's how much bigger, that is how much bigger these super bombs were, the hydrogen bomb were. And these massive bombs, one of these bombs could destroy an entire city. In fact, the bombs are almost too big to have any effectiveness. But once they started building them, they just could not stop. And once the U.S. built them, the Soviets, just 2 years later, they had their, less than 2 years later, they had their hydrogen bomb. And this would become the symbol of the arms race. We're going to go right to here. So I'm not going to show you this. But the United States began to build more and more bombs, test more and more bombs, and focus on atomic war. And this fit in with Eisenhower's theory of nuclear war. He called it the new look. And that is a good place to quit with the new look. So, I'm going to finish this part on Thursday. Tomorrow, 10 a.m., I have to go a little bit earlier. Tomorrow, 10 a.m., I'll do the last review session. And I will go over everything. I will go over anything you ask questions on. I'll also give a couple more examples. We'll do that tomorrow. So that's what we'll do tomorrow. And I'm just looking at my picture. The cartoon Atomic War makes me laugh. So I will go over anything you have in the review section. I'll also give you another sample. I'll do a sample DBQ. I'll talk about other things, but that is tomorrow. And today then is the last day if you want any more points on redoing your DBQ. Tomorrow at noon then, if you turn in your big review packet, remember there are two parts. I took off the last part of page 7 and gave you a separate one, a lot shorter, because I thought you could have a little bit shorter one and still give you the same effectiveness. But if you turn that big one in by tomorrow at noon, I'll give you a little bit of extra credit. So take a picture of it, whatever. And the big thing is, I know they're your notes. I know that it's for your personal use. I wanted you to be concise in your own words. So I'm going to check things to make sure that you did it correctly and went through it. I'm not going to grade each individual one, but I'm going to look at certain specific ones to give you an idea if you were actually thinking about it, not just copying something from some mediocre source. And that's tomorrow. Are there any questions? Good. I will finish today. I am going to watch a little bit of this. So I'm going to watch this and include this to the end, but that's the end of the notes. This talks about the actual super bomb, and it's just a great little video clip. I want to watch it. So that's where we quit.
Knew what the results of the test would be.
Niner,
So here's the very first nuclear test. Mike. I'm going to keep this on the film, but I'm no more notes.
Men who had seen a lot of nuclear tests by 1952, who, when they saw the Mike test, were frightened. It just seemed to keep coming at them as they stood on their ships watching this thing grow and grow until the mushroom cloud was 100 miles across.
With the super, America regained its nuclear preeminence. 9 months later, the Soviet Union successfully tested an H-bomb of its own. Robert Oppenheimer's opposition to the hydrogen bomb was interpreted by government officials as disloyalty to the United States. In hearings held by the Atomic Energy Commission, he was stripped of his security clearance and retired to academic life a broken man. Edward Teller was treated as an outcast by many of his colleagues for testifying against Oppenheimer, but he won the battle of the super. He would go on to advise the government on nuclear issues throughout the Cold War.
Taking to the hills, the rocky cliffs above California's Beverly Hills to visit the first atomic survival house. Only the overhead...
With the world on edge over the threat of nuclear war, Americans invented ways of coping with Armageddon.
Hal Hayes, a bachelor, spent $250,000 on this hideaway where he can sit out any atomic attack in comfort. There's champagne on tap along with a variety of stronger stimulants just... in case anyone needs a bracer when the bombs are falling. And a radiation-proof curtain will keep out the uninvited gamma rays.
The weirdness of the time, the paranoia of the time, the atmosphere was so tense. I remember more than one time walking on the beach, facing New York, but not being able to see it, but there seemed to be a great stillness suddenly. Birds weren't flying. Something was happening, I felt immediately. Everything was just too quiet. And I looked off to the direction of the city just to see if there might be a mushroom cloud rising.
We bought a house on the Berkeley Hill with a big picture window overlooking the Golden Gate. And Emilio Segrè, Nobel Prize winner in physics, came to visit us. He said to my wife, "Charlotte, you will pay for this view with your life." He was afraid that San Francisco would be bombed, an atomic bomb. And he personally moved out of Berkeley back to Walnut Creek, about 20 miles inland over the hill.
There was a turtle by the name of Bert, and Bert the turtle was very alert, and danger threatened
him. A government-sponsored campaign taught children what to do in the event of nuclear attack.
He's duck and cover, duck and cover.
All right, so... that's where I'll quit. Tomorrow, then, 10 o'clock review. Have a good day.